share my screen and we might start. Is it visible?
Yes.
Okay, so multiprocessing in general. Python language is being evolving recently over several years to show to enable us with different ways of doing things in parallel or in an asynchronous manner. We have async keywords, we have new frameworks, but in terms of actually doing things in parallel, we always had several options left, less than different languages. So first, let's overview what do we have, what are these options. So the main ones in terms of doing things in parallel, let's say that in parallel, are threads and processes. And this is common for most of the languages, but for some reason in Python, threads are a bit less useful for doing CPU heavy jobs than we might have in other languages. If you're not familiar with, it's called global interpreter lock. The way, in short, how it works is that there's a global mutex in the whole interpreter, and if we create a new thread inside of the interpreter, all the threads will be bound by this mutex, allowing only single bytecode operation to be executed at once. This effectively means that we cannot really go out of our core process and process things in true parallel. From other perspective, threads are really convenient way to do things in, let's say, parallel or asynchronous manner. One of the things is that we have shared memory. We can basically just have an object in our Python interpreter and pass it as is, not caring about how it will be represented, how the operating system will treat it, because it will be a layer. And we just don't need to think about it. We can just pass the object and it will be cared by the other thread. But again, if we want to do any type of heavy computing on threads, it will really not be useful. We need to go out of and create another process. So processes have this advantage that we actually create a new interpreter, so we're not bound to that. But then the new problems appear. First of all, creating process is somewhat more expensive. This can be mitigated by maybe preemptively creating some processes and having, like, if we know upfront that we will need 5 or 10 or the number of equals to our cores on our machine, this might be mitigated. But another one is a bit more complex, and this is how do we actually share the data between processes. The IPC, the inter-process communication, becomes an issue to solve, and there are a lot of options provided by operating systems and by the programming languages, and in Python, by Python standard library, how to deal with inter-process communication. So maybe let's review shortly what do we have for now and how can we apply that. So how can we share state between processes, between two independent programs that don't have basically anything in common and somehow need to process the data and pass it between all another. We can use files. Like in the most simple example, we can just have one file where one process will be reading and then the other will be writing to it, or they might read from it. Of course, this creates some issues with synchronization, but there are means to that. We have logs and everything that is available in threading. We have that in multiprocessing too. We have pipes which are provided by operating systems, and mostly we have this in POSIX systems. We have like something that is pretty much close in Windows. So this in Linux and Unix systems, this creates like a path to virtual file system. And we can just open those and read and write from these as there were files. We have queues which are possible, enable us to share tasks and task definitions between threads in asynchronous matters. We have operating system signals when we can basically attach handlers to different numbers of signals, different meanings of signals in our process, in our application, in order to just handle specific situations that might occur in the operating system. Then we have sockets, because it's basically internet. And if we have sockets, we have internet, the TCP sockets, we have Unix domain sockets, so which from our perspective might be used the same way. And we can basically try to treat multiprocessing as it was just distributed systems, so we can have some kind of RPC. And we will see later that some solutions in Python standard library for multiprocessing use that approach. And finally, we have shared memories. So we have this way of getting some array of memory, the chunk of just block of memory in operating system, assigning this pointer to the memory to two processes and letting them both interact with that. So up to Python 3.8, we already did have some memory sharing solutions in standard library. It's not that the new shared memory module that appeared in Python 3.8 is something that erases everything that was before. It rather builds on the blocks that were available before and adds options to our use cases. So given that we have a use case that we want to share state, we want to actually have shared piece of memory where every process might access and interact freely with, then we still need to kind of decide what is the area that we need to do, what is the type of the data that we will want to share, and what are we actually going to, like, what is the amount of those objects that we will want to do. Are they the same? Are they all over the place and different? This decision becomes important because as opposed to threads, we cannot just simply pass any kind of objects existing in Python. We have to make compromises, and we have to, in most cases, we just need to go through operating system. That means that we will go with low level and most likely reach at some point C world, where we just operate on structs. So two existing solutions for now were in the multiprocessing module. There is a thing called manager, and the manager object is a quite powerful tool for sharing objects. So the base, that there are several manager objects in multiprocessing, and the base one is able to actually create a server, listen on the socket, and accept connections. We can register some callable and access by calling that callable from another manager that connects to the one that was listening. We can actually access some variables by that. So we can, we have this RPC model where we can basically call the method or of an object as it was on our process and get the data. The problem or the caveat with that is every object needs to be somehow marshaled. I didn't check exactly for manager, but I believe it's done by using Pickle. So every object that we pass over between the processes becomes weighted, because the whole process of passing the object becomes slowed down by needing to pack it and unpack it on both ends. So this kind of creates bottleneck if we want to do this multiple times. Other than that, we have C types, which is pretty good library for interacting with C objects. We are able to just simply define by letter codes the structure in C that represents the C. So basically it was created for interacting with structures or methods or functions in C libraries and then translating them into Python objects. The additional feature is that in shared memory, we have shared C types. And by leveraging that, we can basically share the data instead of marshaling them. We can go like level lower and use the struct representation to share our objects. So the manager has, I will show short examples of the code. Please don't use them on production. The only criteria for the code was to fit on one screen. But there are just minimal examples how to use both of those approaches. So we have a manager. We have a simple worker that sets some key to value, and we want to share a dictionary between objects. So we create a multiprocessing manager, and we create a dict. Please note that it's not a simple dict. It's a dict coming from the manager. It's dict-like objects, but it's specifically implemented to become shareable. Manager also has list-like object that should behave like a list, but well, we need to use this. Then we just create process in jobs, list of processes, five of them. and we just start the jobs and run the jobs. And each of the worker is just accessing the dict as it was a normal dict. It can just write to it and read from it. So it's pretty easy to use. But again, we need to remember that behind the scenes, we have basically an RPC pattern and everything goes through some kind of socket. Everything will be marshaled and unmarshaled. If we have a lot of those, the price of marshaling and unmarshaling the data might overcome the gain of going to multiple cores. So it's something to be aware of. The other thing that is available in the manager is actually namespace. Namespace is something less constricted, less bounded than the dict or list. It's just a namespace, so we can basically create any kind of value there. And as we can see, we just create a manager namespace inside. We have an event just to synchronize between the producer and consumer, create one process for producer, which gets the namespace and assigns the value to that. That's simple. Then we have consumer, which gets the namespace and it's able to read from the value in that. And that's it. The rest is just synchronization. We start them join, and at the end, the consumer is able to read. Again, this is done by the RPC pattern. This is using the marshaling and marshaling underneath. So it's pretty useful. It's easy to understand, easy to use, but comes with the price of being slower. Okay, so what else do we have? We have those shared C types. And shared C types, with using C types, we come to the world of C. So we basically will be using the structures defined by integers, characters, and doubles. We are aware of the types that are actually existing in the machine instead of rich types that we have in Python. So if we want to create a class, or like we have a point that will be representing our point, sorry, with X and Y, we need to define their type. These are basically, we used here double and characters, but eventually there is a format for those C types that are, they are just characters in that formatting characters, and the structure will be created, will be translated to C structure of something that is a type of double and type of double, and represented in memory as just two doubles, and that's it. So it's pretty convenient and pretty fast way and memory efficient way to deal with variables. However, we need to be aware of the types. We need to do additional work and boilerplate on our side to deal with that. So as we can see, we can create an array of points, of characters, and we can just assign something to it. And we can create an array of points. And with that points, we can have a modified function that will be accessing those objects as they are and be able to interact with those objects. So we have the representation on both sides. We deal with Python, but we need to define how it will be stored in memory in terms to deal with this. So additional thing is that this array object accepts is compatible with another array object coming in Python. So it accepts two different formats. If you go to Python library, you will see that there is a format for array object, which is storing Python values, and it's like I or B for bool, I for integer. And this object accepts that, but it also accepts the notation from C types, which is slightly different. Keep that in mind, and advice for me is that just don't mix them in the same code. It becomes a mess. So just stick to one. Other than that, we can just move on and see what else do we have now. So here comes the shared memory module that came in Python 3.8. And it builds a bit from what we've seen, but also adds some new possibilities to the sharing that we can just leverage. The shared memory module is pretty small. As for now, it consists only from three objects. And the first one is shared memory. It's simple as that. This is the basic interface of this. That's mostly what we have. So we have, if we want to create a shared memory object, we just call shared memory. We can name it. This becomes valuable if we want to access this from multiple scripts. Because it will be just created as a shared memory file on the Linux file system, and it can be accessed. Eventually, it will be accessed by bypass. We defined whether we want to create this or we want to attach it to the existing one, and we define the size. The size is defined in bytes. So once again, we operate on low-level memory chunk. Everything that we do in shared memory object is just represented in byte array. So if we want to do something on that, we need to be aware of that. We are dealing with bytes, not objects. The other thing about shared memory and it being low level is, as you can see, we have two methods inside of this to deal with closing the object. So we have the close method that deals with just the instance that we are already working with. And we have the unlink one that is supposed to destroy the underlying shared memory object area in operating system. And it's pretty it becomes pretty hard and to just juggle those by hand. And if you want to use the shared memory object in your code, you need to be specifically, you need to be extra aware of how to open those, which process is creating these objects and is responsible for unlinking and destroying, which objects are just accessing the memory and are responsible for just closing its own stuff. If we have some kind of race between processes and we, for example, unlink something before the other process ends with that, we will end up with some exceptions. And I even had one. I had issues with this, and you will see it in future slides. Other than those methods, as you can see, the buffer is where we actually see the memory as bytes. The name is what we set as the name, and this is read-only. And the size, we can read the size and might be needed for other processes just to deal with that. This is, again, size is read-only value. We cannot change the size of the shared memory object after it's created. And this is a simple example. These are two scripts that are supposed to read from and write to a shared memory object as we have. So the first one is just creating an object. It's giving it a name. We set it to create, and we set the size to 12. We will see how the size works in real world, because we get the guarantee that we will get the 12 bytes at least. But the actual chunk of memory allocated by interpreter might be different. This usually will be different. Given that we are working on bytes, we cannot really just assign strings as we were assigning strings. This is a byte array. So we have to fill something. These are bytes, and we are just running to assigning the particular signs. These are treated, right? We see them as a letters. These are bytes. If we were to print it, they would be just numbers. And we just interrupt our process until something else happens. So for now, we don't care what happens here. We start another process on another terminal. We assign the size, and we connect to the same memory area by name. We specify that we don't want to create it. If we were to create it and there was already the one with the same name, it would be a conflict and we would have an exception. The size is not really important here because we don't create it, we just connect. So it will be skipped and ignored. And then the same mother, we just uppercase what we really have here and print what we have. So we print this as bytes, just not to see the numbers, and then we'll print the actual size of the memory. So let's see how it goes. First script, it says what we were supposed to do, and then it says the size of the chunk. So as you can see, the size of the chunk is 4 kilobytes. We were just asking for 12 bytes, but we got 4 kilobytes. Apparently, the interpreter is not is not caring that much about the efficiency. It needs to just allocate memory in huger chunks. We might want to be aware of this. However, this particular module is designed to deal with large memory chunks, so it doesn't, it's not that necessary. The other thing that is really apparent and visible here, that we have exceptions. And we have exceptions because I've closed those processes in the wrong order. So any type of mismatch here, and we have leaked shared memory, which needs to be cleaned up. You don't want it to happen in real life. What can be done with that? Well, luckily, the next object provided to us by shared memory is the shared memory managers. This is the object that will, like, this is the one that deals with the burden of creating, destroying, and keeping track of the references of to the memory. So what we want to do right now, we want to get the memory manager, and within that memory manager, we will create a shared memory value. And then we don't need to care about freeing the memory, the deallocating, closing, however those methods were called. So it manages the shared memory, and the other shareable list object, which I'll show in a few next slides. What is really great about Shared Memory Manager? It has start method and shutdown method, but also works as a context. Excuse me. So what we really, how do we really want to use it is like that. We have one worker like before and the second worker that does uppercase or whatever. And we just create a shared memory manager. Within it, we create a shared memory. Thing to remember, the shared memory called provided from within the memory manager is has a bit different arguments that the one that comes without it. So here we cannot name it. We just say what is the size, desired size of it. Other than that, we will just create process, pass the shared memory within the manager, and everything works as expected. No issues. Other than something that is, I would call like growing pains of the module itself, because you can see that I've called a free support function, and according to Python documentation, free support function is something that supports freezing application into its own executable on Windows. So if you want to create executable from Python on Windows, you need to use it in multiprocessing, otherwise it won't work. Funny thing is, I'm working on Mac. And somehow this is affected. Somehow people were telling that this problem occurs. This has been accepted as bug. And as for Python 3.9.7, this is still there. So there's something to be aware of if you're on system different than Linux. There are dragons, and there might be some surprises to that. Other than that, it's pretty simple to use, other than shared memory object being, again, pretty low level. And if you want to deal with NumPy and store NumPy variables there, you're great. It's ready to go. If you really want to share some of higher level object in Python, this becomes a bit annoying, or like it becomes a chore. So here comes something that is bit higher level object that is quite good for accessing and sharing objects that we have in Python. Again, we cannot share everything, but we get a list-like object that we can access by square brackets, by index notation, insert things inside and pick up things from that. The thing is that we cannot store everything. We can store integers, floats, bools, the non-type, and we can store strings and bytes. And the nice thing is that we don't have to deal with byte arrays or anything. We can store the string. The thing is that it needs to fit in 10 megabytes. That's the limitation. But again, who stores, like if you don't store the strings bigger than 10 megabytes, you're good to go. We can just start. We cannot change the length of that list. So it's not a true list in Python world, but it provides some of the list interface. It can count the objects inside of it, and it can index the objects inside of it. And since it's a list, we can mix those types. So the first object might be integer, the next might be a string, the other might be something else, and it's fine. We don't need to, it's not an array. We don't need to keep the same type of object to in the whole collection. And we can actually access the underlying shared memory object. And the way this is stored is defined in the read-only format, which actually tells us in C-types format what is the underlying structure in C to store that shareable list. So if we would like to recreate it somehow low-levelly, we can just refer to that format. So we can refer to that format and deal with that. We can do it ourselves. So how is it used? We create a shared memory manager. I've skipped the option to create it as independent object because it's not really that much different from the normal one. We create a shareable list and then we don't say what's the size. We create it with iterable. So we just initiate it with some kind of list or whatever that we have, like generator. We create a list from that, not from size. And then we just assigned some work to it with simple worker that gets the list as argument and has some boundaries to work on. We start the process, wait for them to finish in that point, and we can basically see what's the result of both processes being working in true parallel. We can sum up what is there so we can have some processing. What else is to be desired? Like this is basically what this module provides to us. And from my playing with this module, what for me, what's left to be desired and something to look into the future is that the memory manager is a subclass of base manager. And it would be expected from me to provide it the same way to deal with RPC. So we would be able to register some kind of resource and then access it from another manager that connects to it. So we can have some callable and access some variables, but I was unable to pass the shared memory object between those. So that's something to be left. I mean, I did left a bit of a bitter taste for me because I was expecting that, okay, I will create the same managers in two scripts. The one will start it, the second will connect to it. I will access the shared memory object as it's supposed to be, as I was doing low-levelly, but I would need to deal with the allocation and all this boring stuff, but somehow this is not yet there. So there's something to be remembered to that. It's still growing. It still has some quirks, like we have this free support on Mac for some reason and it's to be solved. It grows. So, but it's kind of exciting to see that something happens in that area. And as a language, we are not just giving up on having ways to do things in multiple processors, and we are opening to truly process things in parallel when we need it. With that words, thank you. If you have any questions, I'll try to answer them.